If we can, let's call the meeting to order. First item is discussion input from local boards regarding value statements. I think we might just comment briefly, if anybody would like to, on exactly what our purpose is here today. What are we setting out to accomplish? And where do we expect to go? If anybody would like to comment on that? Jonathan, you want to? You see, well, this is something that you really kind of piloted through for us. I accept your leadership on it.
Well, where are we at? To refresh everybody's memories, that it's kind of like a tier system. The first level is for us to establish what we feel are our values, what's behind what the high school and the district is. The next level is to take those values and say, okay, what would the ideal high school look like based on those values? And then the last thing is the goals we would pursue to achieve the ideal. So what we're trying to do tonight is to, I think in conjunction with Matt, is come up with some sort of values that can help define what we think an ideal high school should look like.
Well, does this line up according to what you said, the agenda? Should we be changing this agenda around?
I don't think it can change a special meeting agenda.
We can add to it?
You cannot add to a special meeting.
No, but can we change the items around? Okay. Are these items okay? Because first we're going to discuss what we got from our local board. Is that right?
Yeah, if people got some alarming comments that should send us in a different direction or something, we can discuss that. The feedback I got was pretty similar to what we had in the retreat.
Right.
I think if you look at the high school side goals on their webpage, it's pretty similar to the stuff we came up with.
So our board hasn't met yet.
Can we pass these down to Gail?
They said our board hasn't met yet, Sharon, so I don't have it in this book.
Neither is Salisbury.
I think Salisbury's seen them, but they didn't have any. They didn't comment on it.
Their meeting is what? And then week there, right after Thanksgiving.
Ours is Monday.
This is in September. We didn't do it.
Yeah, and I just simply talked to individual board members. And they were all on character, honesty, generosity, respect, responsibility, and so on. And they did a little bit of prioritizing for me, but that was done as individual, not at federal board meetings.
Did the Falls Village board do anything?
The what?
About these? Did they discuss?
No, I don't know, and I don't know why it was sent to the OPCC meeting.
They did receive these, and they were shared with the board, and if they were to have comment, they were to contact Gail. Or actually Jonathan. So I did.
Why would they contact Jonathan if I'm their representative?
He was organizing this little workshop for us.
I missed the second retreat meeting. Could somebody tell me what was the rationale behind sending the Region 1 board's process to the ABC committee?
Well, we didn't send it to the ABC committee. Each of us were supposed to go to our boards to get feedback.
Why? Yes. This is supposed to be the Region 1 board's goals. And
well, don't we represent the region? Wouldn't it be good to at least get some feedback from our boards on what we're doing?
Well, they don't ask for our feedback on what they're doing.
I think the reason that we kind of did it was because they feed into our school and we kind of wanted them to be part of what we are. Yeah. Because of our goals are kind of based on, they feed into us, so we were hoping for their cooperation, I guess, and feedback on our goals.
On defining our goals?
Well, this is what the leaders had us do. This came from the people that were presenting this to us.
Well, I watched the tape. I didn't see them say that. But anyway, it's done, so.
So at least three of us have not gotten input from our board yet.
Well, it doesn't mean we can't proceed in conjunction with Matt and create some sort of draft statement that can then be more formally presented to the other boards or not.
Mm-hmm. Now, Mr. Harnett.
Hi.
I see you listed here on the agenda.
I do too.
What would you like to present to us?
Well, I mean, you invited me to kind of talk about the goals for the high school and sort of where we're at, where we're going. I guess kind of how that dovetails off of the different things that you guys are discussing as your values, your goals, your core beliefs. There's a lot of different ways to define those, but I don't know. It sounds like you're in the process of kind of developing your core beliefs and values kind of along the lines the way the school did with the NEASC visit, and how those things picture it and piece that together. You know, I know for me, a lot of the goal work, you know, that I had talked about and things I'm focusing on with teachers and students at the school this year, one is getting the students at the forefront of the focus, focusing on the work at hand. You know, what are we doing to, you know, change that climate and that culture and kind of move away from and back to a focus that's on that, you know, move away from some of the things that we kind of got bogged down in the past and, you know, keep that focus on the teachers in terms of working with the kids to help them achieve more. You know, a lot of things that we've been talking about this year, both with students and the adults working in the building, have to do with climate and culture. What do we want the values in that climate and that culture to reflect, and how is that going to have an impact on the learning and the instruction that's going on? You know, how do all these different pieces fit together? And, you know, we're doing some things with the students, we're doing some things with the adults. You know, last year with the teachers in the building, we started doing instructional rounds inside the building, which is, you know, a big part of really just getting people used to the idea of getting feedback from their colleagues and the people they work with on a day-to-day basis, but also being comfortable with them just visiting each other's classrooms and observing practice and seeing what other people are doing. I don't think many people in the past had that opportunity to visit their colleagues during the day when they had a period, you know, whether it be a planning period or a prep period, to go and kind of observe, nor do I think they really felt like they could. And so we're trying to set up a system and put a structure in place that encourages and promotes them to go and observe each other, talk about the ideals behind best practice, you know, what are they doing in the classroom, why did they take this approach? You know, what kind of results are they getting with these, you know, with the practices that they're engaging in? You know, I'm pushing a lot of different things with using technology as a tool to improve that engagement. You know, there's a lot of things along those lines.
Matt, does that fit that concept of teachers working together and collaborating with the new professional learning standards?
Well, I mean, you know, you've gotten a lot of information about the new evaluation program that's coming down the pipe from the state. You know, there are different expectations, different levels of accountability, and part of that does dovetail together where, you know, what are teachers doing to collaborate, to develop ideals behind best practice? How are those reflections of ideals from the community? How do those things fit with the expectations we have of students? How do those things, more importantly, fit with the expectations we have of ourselves, professionals? You know, I've had many conversations with folks about raising the standard. And when people, you know, it's a very nice conversation to have when people sit around and talk about raising the standard. But, I mean, when you get down to it, what does that really mean? What standards are you talking about raising, and who are you raising them for? You know, I don't think we should not only be raising them for the students, but we need to raise them for ourselves. I don't think we should expect anything less of our students sitting in front of us than we do ourselves, you know, and hold ourselves to those standards.
The 2011 National Staff Development Council standards include two components that are important and very related to what Matt was just describing with instructional rounds. The first component is that all schools will have learning communities, that there will be learning communities formed within the school, And then the foundational piece to that is you can't have a learning community without a collaborative environment. So collaboration is a beginning that will eventually lead to the development of a professional learning team of some sort. And the new regulations require that we have continuous and ongoing professional learning opportunities for teachers, if you recall. But the old model of what we call sit and get, the old model of 3 days, old standalone days, are not enough anymore. So that instructional rounds component that Mr. Harnett was talking about really embraces the new learning standards.
How do you define a learning community?
I could define it if you gave me about a week of time, but it's professionals coming together, setting target growth goals, and working toward those goals. So a learning community could center around what interventions will we provide students that are struggling in mathematics? And that learning community is going to solve that problem. What additional interventions might we try that we haven't tried? The professional learning community could be studying any topic that's a building goal. So if Mr. Harnett has established a topic or a goal in his building, there could be professional learning communities and varying sizes of groups working on those goals in different ways.
And you have some structures that are inherently built into most high schools throughout the state that kind of lend themselves to those communities. The departments, you know, defining themselves around an academic area. But you also want to sometimes break away from that. You don't want the same group of teachers who teach the same subject sitting around talking about the same thing all the time. You sometimes want to integrate and cross, you know, for lack of a better way of saying, cross-pollinate and put a math teacher, a science teacher, and an English teacher together to talk about what are they doing in their respective areas and how might those things be used in different areas in the school to address concerns, be they academic, be they cultural, be they community, whatever it is.
So that's what's new, it's like cross-subject.
Well, I mean, I think what you're seeing with a lot of the new standards that are coming down the pipe, both from the state and the feds with regards to things like Common Core, a big part of Common Core is that cross-curricular piece. You know, there's things, science, there's a lot of integration of science and math. There's a lot of integration of social studies and English, some of which we are already doing on a particular level, but they expect to see more of it. And they want to see that stuff grown. Because, you know, as Patricia was saying, a lot of things that were done X number of years ago where people could operate in isolation, you can't do that anymore, really, to a certain degree. You have to be a much more integrated. You have to be willing to collaborate, and you have to be willing to reach into those other areas to develop those, not only be able to develop those relationships, but figure out how is what I do integrate with what you're doing to make school, you know, more productive and achieve at a higher level.
So can you translate that into a goal for the high school for us?
In a simple sentence? Right. No, I mean,
or help us create more.
You know, I'll tell you a couple different things with regard to that. I mean, because I was thinking about this in terms of what I wanted to kind of get across to you guys in terms of, you know, where I see the high school and kind of what I would like to have develop. There are many, many good things happening at this high school right now. But at the same time, there's things that we need to improve upon. You can say that about any institution, I don't care whether it's public school or private business, wherever it is. What I would like to see in the classroom here at the high school is students and teachers working together where they, you know, a teacher facilitates and guides a student towards discovering the material that they need to master, the content that they need to, you know, grasp and demonstrate mastery of. And I see that happening in an environment that is interactive, that is engaging, that is rich in technology, using all those tools, because the problem that we have today is that kids have access to the information. When all of us were pretty much in school, there was information we needed to get from the teacher in the room. Kids have access to that information now. What we have to figure out and what we have to develop in them is the ability not only to access that information, how to interpret it, how to verify it and confirm that it's valid, but then also how to apply it. And how are they going to use it to solve problems, to develop the relationships and get to the next level that they want to get to. I keep saying to a lot of people is, the kids here will do anything we ask them to do, but what are we asking them to do? And why are we asking them to do it? For some kids, it's go to class, take a test, here's your grade, here's your credit. Is that what we're really after? Or, you know, is there a bigger picture we want to try to focus on? Some of the things that you guys have in this packet here, I mean, I was kind of looking at, and, you know, there's nothing here that you wrote down that says, well, they should know all, you know, 44 presidents and vice presidents and the dates they were inaugurated. That's information. They can get that information. Yeah. But, you know, you have things down, you have values down here that you list off: character, excellence, citizenship, collaboration, and, you know, on the next page here, you know, you have generosity, passion, enthusiasm, and there was the fourth page in, where you have an ideal at the top of the page, and you list off all these things about students, some of which we can control and some of which we can't. You know, we don't have, you know, you have one of the things you have done, you know, each student very enthusiastic about school and having a great time learning. Okay, we can't control that. We really can't. But we can develop an environment that we can put them in that hopefully spurs that.
Yeah,
that,
well,
and
that's
ignites
the,
that, that's the, you know. But I'm just looking at the way it's phrased, you know, the way it's phrased here on this paper, you know.
So what can the board do? What goal can the board set that will help you to do what you said you want to do, which is encourage student-teacher collaboration, in short name? What can we do to help that?
I think one of the things, and I mean, I am not telling you guys how to do what it is that you have to do, but, you know, for me, it's like I try to focus on the high school, but what I'm finding myself is my scope is growing and increasing because I'm looking at all the things that feed into the high school and all the different schools that impact that. And, you know, there's a bigger global perspective that we got to kind of start talking about, because I've started having a lot of conversations with the elementary principals who are sending us kids and having those conversations. And you kind of ask, what's that professional learning community? You know, we have 6 different elementary schools in 6 very different towns feeding us kids. And the common experiences that are among them and the skill set that which they come with, you can take a freshman teacher and you can sit them down in front of you and you can put 20 freshmen in front of them and they can do a couple of assessments and they will very quickly determine which school kids are from and not be told that information in advance.
Share that with us.
Because they know there's certain things that are emphasized at certain schools, and those will be the strengths that those schools emphasize them. And that's not to say that one school is doing something better than the other. There's just certain things that are, you know, emphasized at other places. And that's true, though. I mean, that's not just an anomaly for this place. I mean, that's true. That's been true wherever I've been, you know. And to kind of start bringing that together, I mean, that's a real challenge. And I think that's one of the challenges that you guys have as a board, is how to get this rolling where, you know, the schools are kind of, you know, you have those mutually assured experiences and kids are rolling up here. We're getting good kids, and we're getting kids who can produce, but I mean, they're scattered across the continuum. And I don't think there's been a lot of conversation, or there's been attempts at it, and I don't think it's been something that's perpetuated, where, you know, the freshman and sophomore teachers have had a lot of chance to sit down and have a conversation with the 7th and 8th grade teachers about what are they doing, what are we doing, and what are we seeing, and, you know, is that information, you know, flowing back and forth.
How do we create that?
Well, one of the things that, I mean, I've been having conversations with the elementary principals, and we've been talking, and you've heard me talk last year, we made the move to Power School, and the elementary schools are starting to begin the conversation of doing the same thing next year. And really what that's going to facilitate is a flow of uniform information from place to place, because they're going to be able to put information into the same system, and we all have access to that information. It's not coming to us in dribs and drabs and in different formats and different pieces where, you know, one school sent us this, another school sent us that. That uniform information. So when an 8th grade kid rolls up here, we have all the same information. It's in the same format, and we have similar assessments, and all the information is in one place, and we can sort through it and get a better picture. And I mean, that's some of the stuff that happens in August when they do that, you know, the data team that gathers around this table right here to look at the incoming freshmen. But to put more uniformity to that would be really helpful.
And that can be done through that technology?
Well, that can be done. That can be done just getting people.
Interaction between
teachers.
Well,
both. You know, I mean, because I think when you start getting people looking at and putting information in the same way, and the results that are, you know, the information that's coming out of that, and we sit down and look at it. It's not, okay, well, here's this information from this school, and it looks like this is going on here. You're getting the same information across the board, and you're getting it in the same format. So you don't really have to spend a lot of time deciphering it. What does it really mean? It's all spelled right there in front of you. But I think, you know, having more uniformity across the board, you know, is not a bad place to start. But that's a challenge. It's a real challenge because, you know, you've got six very different schools and very different towns that feed into this place, that getting them together is a difficult thing. Because you have to be respectful of the time that teachers need to be with kids. You can't keep pulling teachers out of classrooms to get them together for these, you know, regional meetings where you get all the seventh grade teachers in the district together. You know, which is a challenge because you're scattered from one end, you know, one end of the corner to the other here in the Northwest. And you have to, you know, you want teachers in classrooms working with kids, but at the same time, you got to give them that collegial time to be together to collaborate. So it's a major catch-22 because you can only pull them out so much before they kind of say, well, you know, I have to be with my kids, I got to work with my kids.
Well, are they meeting now?
They do, yes. But, you know, time is the biggest resource that a lot of us don't have enough of. And I mean, that's kind of, I have a scheduling meetings with the teachers at the high school to take a look at the current schedule the high school operates on, because I don't think we're maximizing the time to the best of our ability for teachers and students to be working together, let alone teachers to be working together where it's teacher to teacher. Because there's only so much time during the course of the day. And if you look at the number of instructional hours that the high school currently has in place, we're right at, you know, bare minimum. So, I mean, there's got to be different ways we can maximize that. But, I mean, not only do we need more time with kids, but we also have to build into the schedules more time for teachers to be able to collaborate. Now, I have the benefit that, you know, we're all here in one place. It's harder for, you know, Kent middle school teachers to collaborate with North Canaan middle school teachers because geographically they're separated, you know.
So if we're moving towards the use of technology, there are things like Skype,
yep,
there are GoToMeeting,
mm-hmm,
there are all kinds of ways that they don't have to travel and,
right,
they could do that.
But I don't think all schools have that infrastructure and that capacity built in, and that's one of the things they're looking at and that they're starting
it's
now
just
to pick
the
up.
Internet.
Right, but the bandwidth in the schools, the infrastructure within the school, I don't know if they have, you know, they have the capacity. I mean, I know I've had conversations with Lisa Carter, and she's really looking at what's going on in Salisbury, and I mean, you may have heard, you know, she's trying to beef up their network and make sure that the teachers have those same access to those tools. And, you know, that's coming, and they're working on it, but we got to get that stuff in place. And then once those tools are in place, then make sure people know how to use them and that we're maximizing it. Because you're right. I mean, a group of teachers in Kent could have a conversation with a group of teachers in North Canaan via Skype or Uvu or any of those things that would allow them to communicate. And they don't physically have to be in the same room together. But I just don't think people have laid that on the table in front of everybody and said, here, on this day, at this time, you're going to have this meeting from this school, and you guys are just going to talk via the computer.
Actually, they've done that with wikis.
Yeah.
The high school math in particular have worked with the middle school teachers and the high school via wikis, and they've been sharing information back and forth,
mm-hmm,
sharing assessments that are appropriate, like algebra, for instance,
yeah,
from the high school to the middle
school. I know Scott Fellows has been doing that this year with some Google Docs, with the Algebra 1 curriculum and sharing some stuff with the middle school teachers. I know that's happened this year. I can't speak to what happened, you know, 2 years ago or things like that. I don't know if they've done that.
But Gail, just for an example, and Sharon, we gave all of our teachers iPads,
mm-hmm,
and we had issue with them all working together with bandwidth that we hadn't kind of thought about much. So there was an issue with that. So we're dealing with that.
Well,
I'm not a tech person, so I don't know, but I know there was an issue.
They can't
so
get on the internet?
Too many at the same time.
Prior to doing it here at the high school, that was a conversation I had with Gina, Jasmine, and Jonathan Warren in terms of, if we start putting all these devices on here and we start loading up and putting more devices, what's our bandwidth? Is the traffic going to bog it down and make it slow and do all this other stuff? So we had to do certain things to beef up our Wi-Fi and beef up the, you know, the internet capacity before all those devices could get on there and do it. That's what we were doing last year at this time. You know, and that's kind of, I know Lisa's doing that with Salisbury now. She's looking at all that because she wants to get iPads and all the hands and people have kind of learned from each other. I know, you know, exactly what Marilyn was talking about is true, is, you know, if you don't have these conversations beforehand and you just throw that out there, it's going to lock it up, and it's not going to work. And I've, Gina Jasmine has been doing a lot of stuff, you know, regionally now. I mean, she's been having conversations with different tech people at different schools. And, you know, Jonathan Warren is starting to kind of piggyback in there right behind her in terms of talking about the network. Because I know there's, and you may be able to help me out on this, there's local area ACTS networks, LANs, and then there's WANs, which are wide area network. We are currently, and I may be wrong, we are currently not a wide area network, we're only local area networks. And the difference would be with the local areas, everybody has their own little, like the high school's got theirs, the Kent school has theirs. But if we go to a wide area network that's a regional network, and everybody's on the same network, and my understanding is that that's going to improve the capacity for everybody, but it's got to be managed and it's got to be regionalized. So we got to kind of move in that direction too.
Matt, to your uniformity issue, which I think is really a critical one, do you think the Common Core state standards K-12 will help with that?
It's definitely providing the opportunity to have those conversations. I mean, and it's also providing the opportunity to bring about that change. You can't ignore Common Core. I mean, that's a state mandate. That's, you know, something that's happening and being dictated to us federally as well. You have to do those things. So, I mean, you know, that's the chance to not only look at what you're doing, but you have to look at what you have to be doing according to these mandates. And it's the opportunity to bring about some of that change and also sync some of that stuff up. I know I sent Scott Fellows with another math teacher from here, because I had a conversation with my colleagues in the Berkshire League, meaning Litchfield and Wamogo and the other high schools that are there. I meet with the principals from those schools 4 times a year, and we kind of talk about the different issues that we're having and the things that are going on in their schools. And we also talk about coordinating and collaborating. This somewhat goes back to your thing about professional learning communities. We started talking about Common Core and some of the different things that are going on in our schools. So we started with math, because math seemed to be the one that was the furthest along in terms of having an understanding of where they're going and what they need to accomplish with Common Core. They just got together about 2 weeks ago at Northwest, the department heads and a teacher from each department, talk about what are those schools doing about Common Core, what are the things they're implementing, how is it impacting their program, what's the effect in sharing the ideas and going across, you know, across schools now and across school districts to share and collaborate. There's some Google Docs that are flowing back and forth. I know they plan to get together again after the holidays, because, you know, that's the way we're going to, you know, that's what's kind of happening here. I've had a lot of conversations with Alan Strauss, who's the new principal at Gilbert, because he's a little bit behind us, but he's on board with the iPads and creating a one-to-one environment and doing those things. And he and I were talking about doing some distance learning and having some classrooms start to do exactly what Gail was just talking about, where some classrooms where a freshman English class at Gilbert could work with a freshman English class at Housatonic to do some community work, but also, you know, do some Common Core work and start doing some cross-district work along those lines in terms of what are we doing and where are we going. But, I mean, it emphasizes some of the things that you guys have in here with the collaboration, the communication, the problem-solving, the critical thinking. We just got to figure out, you know, how we're going to do that logistically. And he's building up his infrastructure. We've built up ours. And we're going to put these tools in people's hands and move them in this direction so they can start doing it.
So I heard a goal in there. Technology-rich environment.
Mm-hmm.
Would that be accurate?
Yep.
Okay.
But state it as a goal. How do we state that as a goal?
To attain a technology.
That's okay. So that's what
I don't want to put words in Matt's mouth.
No, but this is, we're working on goals for us, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how do we help Matt do that?
Well, Matt went through a bunch of, talked about a learning community. As a board, couldn't we have a value that we want to establish and maintain a greater learning community, not like a department, but that involves students, teachers, administrators, us, whatever,
yeah.
A learning community, and that can turn into a goal of one of the ways you can have, one of the aspects of a learning community is collaboration, which we got listed in here. An aspect of collaboration is promoting the use of iPads. That's students and teachers collaborating, or our school and the way that information can go out to the parents?
I think you started that the other day at the board meeting when you guys agreed to the goal of being paperless by January. And that was huge. That sent a big message. That was a big statement. That was a big step. I mean, that, you know, that starts at the top and kind of trickles down from there, where that opens up the door for me to push more people in that direction. And, you know, and I mean, that's going to change the way we do business.
So, how about, as it, just in throwing up this idea, a goal for this board would be help create a learning community that includes board members, administrators, teachers, and students through technology-enhanced collaboration. Up for edit. Up for edit.
I think you might even, you know, I mean, that's not a bad opening statement.
Just an opening.
Yeah, would you repeat that?
Yeah, help create. Region 1 Board of Ed will help create a learning community that includes board members, administrators, teachers and students, and maybe other people, through technology-enhanced collaboration. Still not used to this thing. Sure, I'm always looking for
You could even stop that statement if you wanted to, right at where she ends with students. Help create a learning community that includes board members, administrators, teachers, and students.
Yeah, but I think that mentioning the technology, you know, grounds it in how we're going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, up for a comment.
Seems like it would almost work backwards from us having to then go to the ABC committee or to our towns and say, this is what we need at the high school, and be more involved about what we're doing to get our local, to get Falls Village, to get Salisbury into the same gear of when they get to the high school.
So how about that statement, help create a learning community that includes board members, administrators, teachers, students through technology enhanced collaboration and encourage the elementary schools to participate,
mm-hmm.
or whatever.
One of the nice things that I've noticed about this district, when there's a lead, and it works, it's a good idea, the other schools catch right on and pick it up and do it. I would maybe suggest, and not trying to wordsmith, but you're really supporting via a board, aren't you? Supporting learning communities that include, et cetera, those statements.
Say that again?
I think you're really supporting the development of learning communities through board action. And that board action could include technology purchases, it could include setting policies surrounded about those technology purchases. Matt's going to actually do the creating and the work of it. You're going to support, is my understanding, of what you want to do is support his work.
So say, help support the creation of a learning community?
Comprising board teachers.
I think that's our function.
Yeah, I think
that's
so.
We already have that as our vision. The vision for our regional schools is to be a strong learning community.
Correct.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
So.
We got it.
But this would be like a goal for that, right? How to do that?
Well, and that, Marilyn, that would be a value. And then we could put a goal, for instance, our school's already happening here. We could make our goal for this year to help the high school. Or help us afford iPads for all the students.
Well, you could have a lot of action steps.
By finding some kind of...
Yeah, because we have a lot of these things already. I'm just saying that it sounds like we're just rehashing what we already have, which there's nothing wrong with. I mean, we have continued to upgrade technology. That's mm-hmm. what we're doing. That's what we've been doing. That's what we're doing by giving iPads. The Science and Tech Center, that's what we're doing. We're upgrading technology. And the strong learning communities, and there's collaboration is in here. And these are a lot of things that we already have. I think when you start talking about values and goals, and they're kind of all nice things.
And we are
doing that, and we have those. I don't hear or see anything that's a lot different than what we're already doing and what we already have down on paper.
Okay, so I was saying that we should create like an actual goal, like an achievable goal, a measurable goal. Like we're going to do this by.
Well, that would be board action, right?
Board spending money on infrastructure or some practical actual action.
Those are the action steps. Those become your action plan. A good example of an action step would be one you did last month. You know, by December, we're going to be paperless. That's an action step that you're taking toward a goal of modeling. Your goal is to model the use of technology.
But a goal should work towards an end, right?
Absolutely.
So if you don't have an end, that's what we're trying to create here. The values are to try to create ends so that the yearly goals can be working towards those ends. To simply have a goal, accomplish it, that's more like a checklist. That's just saying, okay, we're going to do this by then, check, it's done. And what does it mean? What does it do? Is it getting you closer to something, or is it just you accomplished it? And in the past, one of the problems with technology at this school in the past was you had this step over there, that step over there, that step over there, and you had this motley mix of technology that was sort of falling apart. Now there's a goal with the one-to-one, mm-hmm. which is a philosophy. How you do that doesn't have to be iPads.
Right.
One-to-one is a philosophy of how you're going to handle technology.
Do we have a technology plan?
Yeah. We have one the state gets.
Yeah. You have what?
We have one the state gets. We have to file one with the state in 5 years. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They just filed a new one, which is probably inaccurate because it was filed before the iPad mm-hmm. issue. So
it was filed about 3 months after I got here.
Yeah. So I think one of the things you're
kind of discussing is, you know, a task versus a goal. Yeah. You know, and what are you setting out in front of you? Some of the stuff we're talking about is a task. I mean, like improving the infrastructure at the high school. That was a task we did last fall. You know, I mean, and that's been done. You know, the goal, or one of the goals that, you know, we're working on, and this isn't something that's going to get achieved. I can't say that, you know, by June we're going to be this, because one of the goals we're talking about is using technology in the classroom as a tool to improve student engagement. How that's going to look, how we're going to measure that, and how we're going to make certain that we're achieving that is what I'm engaged in conversation with some of the teachers about. There are some teachers, you know, who are right out there in front and jumping with it, and there's others that are kind of saying, well, wait a minute, now is this really what we should be doing? Is this what we can do? And you know, is this going to work? There's still some people who are afraid of technology, you know, because their experiences with it in the past here was it was not reliable. So we're trying to make it more reliable and, you know, make sure.
It was off in all sorts of different directions.
Yeah, you know, I mean, and there was different things that are happening. So, I mean, you know, the goal, I mean, I want to see, a goal that I have is create, you know, is I want to see an engaging, interactive, rich environment here where teachers and students are working together to, for lack of a better way of saying it, to discover the learning that they need to accomplish in that classroom. It will be a technology-rich environment. It will be a collaborative environment. It'll be a cooperative environment. I mean, all those things are different qualities that are kind of reflective of the climate and the culture. You know,
well, then
right.
It's very important that you have the interactive.
Yep.
Because that is, when you get all the technology, you're going to want all the teachers to know what and how it's going in every classroom.
Right. Right. You know, the thing you got to remember, I mean, technology is just the tool. It's not the magic bullet that's going to cure everything. You know, teachers still have to work with kids to guide them and to help them achieve and to facilitate the learning that we want to see going on. I just think it's changing and it's morphing and it's going in different directions. Common Core is moving it that way. I think the new teacher evaluation system is moving it that way. You know, the learning and the teaching and the instructing is going to take on a different form, and it's going to look very different than it did when you and I were sitting in a classroom. You know, I mean, right now, if we get up out of these chairs and we go from classroom to classroom in this building, and we start looking at just how it's physically set up, if we walk into those classrooms, what do you think you're going to see?
Just like it used to be.
you're gonna see the desks in rows, and you know there's gonna be a place in the front where somebody can stand and you know deliver what they got to deliver, and the students are supposed to sit. I mean, it's very, very much the way it was when you and I were in schools. One of the things that you know we're starting to have conversations about is that flipped classroom. And the teacher's no longer the center of attention, they're more of that facilitator and their guide, and they're sitting next to and working with the student instead of in front of disseminating information. Because this, what's that? Some do, some don't. It depends. There are times when direct instruction is very, very necessary and very appropriate, but it shouldn't be the dominant method that is being used. And you know, there's a level of comfort there, and you have to move some folks in different directions to get them to a comfort level where it's okay to turn over the learning to the kids and let them discover and let them kind of stumble and move their way through stuff, but you guide them and you facilitate and you help them understand, here's what I need you to do. How you get there is the journey that the kid goes on, but the teacher helps guide and facilitate them there. You know, they don't just say, okay, here are the six answers to these questions, I'm gonna give you a quiz on it next week, let's make sure you memorize those and know what those are.
So let's go back to my last question. If the board were to support you mm-hmm. in your vision, mm-hmm. what would you like the board to do to support
first,
you?
First, you could give me a blank check and just say, go, Matt, spend as much money as you want to have all.
That's a task. As you said, that's a task. That's a step.
You know, I guess one of the things is, I guess for lack of a better way of saying it, is you know is participating in this trip. You know, it is to not be a bystander on that, but kind of be part of that process in terms of, you know, be in the school, see what's going on, so you understand and you see firsthand what goes on and how those different things work. And for some that's hard because I understand, you know, different people are doing different things, but when you have the opportunity to engage in a conversation with the students or observe the teachers working or, you know, watch a class in the school, kind of see what that's looking like and you know, is it moving and is it accomplishing different things? You guys need, probably more so than boards in the past, you need to be much more aware of the Common Core and what those expectations are. You need to be very aware of this new evaluation process that's coming down the pipe because it's going to change dramatically. Just, I mean, how I do my work on a daily basis. Because next year, I mean, July 1st, 2013, the new teacher evaluation plan is supposed to go in place.
What is that for? Do you have the document already?
Well, we submit our plan to the state March. Is it March now?
The first submittal is actually January, where the boards have to say we are either accepting the state plan in its entirety or we're going to submit a hybrid. We've been working on sort of the hybrid mm-hmm. of it. We don't have to submit the actual plan until they're saying mid-March. That could change. That date seems to move around a bit. So mid-March mm-hmm. is the current target.
But also what I've heard too, and I mean, Patricia, please, you know, correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, there's supposed to be a new teacher evaluation plan that is either the hybrid model or the state model. That goes into effect July 1st, 2013, which is basically the start of the new school year.
That's correct.
For those of us. The very first year, every single certified individual gets six evaluations, three formal, three informal.
We only get six?
Per the current plan.
Per the current plan.
Really? We're getting 18 times.
Are you really?
Yeah.
Individually?
Correct.
Wow.
How many?
We're supposed to be observed 18 times this year.
There's also a pilot study. Well, there's also a pilot. This is a
for
pilot.
The administrators, group. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
there's a pilot study being done, and the
but you know,
University
just
of Connecticut's
do some very device. Simple math in terms of this. Let's, you know, this is I've been meeting with the Berkshire League principals and stuff. Wamogo and Litchfield are piloting the state's plan right now, so I've been having a lot of conversations with them about what are you doing, how does this work, what's going on, do you like, do you not
60
like.
Pages.
It's crazy in terms of some of the parts of it in terms of what they have to do, but the new plan calls for every single teacher, regardless of the most veteran to the least experienced, everybody gets six evaluations, three formals, three informals.
For you.
The state fund.
Per year.
The first year minimum. That's what it has to be right out of the chute. Every single evaluation has to be accompanied by a written document followed by a verbal conversation. But all the formal ones required a pre-conference as well in terms of what am I going to see, what's going on. All of which, you know, so you have three formals which have pre- and post-conferences and the informals which have post-conferences. There's 53 certified teachers in this building that I would have to observe.
That's all the teachers.
Over 300 evaluations.
Observations.
There's 180 school days. You know, the math just doesn't work out in terms of, you know, not only do I have to do this.
Is it written after each formal?
What's that?
Is it written up after each formal?
It needs to be, and it needs to be done. And I mean, there's actually specific time frames.
And the teacher has the right to a conference afterwards to contest anything that you.
Not even so much contest, but just discuss. You know, this is what was observed. They had a chance to provide their feedback. I mean, you know, they can add an addendum to what I've written.
That's all you'd be able to do in a day.
And does the.
I mean, two a day.
Does
with
the state
all the people.
Lay out all the forms and
oh yeah, there's that's the state form, and I mean our own too. So I mean that's where that hybrid thing, because you can steal some stuff from the state, you can you know have some stuff for your own.
So what
the
happens
states,
if you do three?
Well, in the first year, that's not going to fly. The state wants to see it because the other
actually,
thing you have
think,
to do.
Actually, I think we can set our own standard. We were just told this last week that you may set a standard that's different from the six in your first year.
Mm-hmm.
Six is the state model. There is a minimum, I believe, of three that will be required by the state guidelines. But the long and the short of it is, in our current structure, if you estimate about 20 hours per person on a six-hour observation, we don't have enough people to support that commitment to truly get out of it what we want. And the purpose of the teacher evaluation is a growth opportunity for teachers to get better. And if we really want it to be that, we're going to have to look at how we do the teacher evaluation process. Who has input to it? Do teachers have input to it? And this board's had a lot of discussions about teachers evaluating teachers in past history. So there's so many movable parts right now. It's difficult to say exactly what our hybrid's going to be and what it has to be. Soon, we meet actually next, the 29th, I believe, we have an all-day meeting with the state folks to help us through this.
So does the board have to approve this evaluation process?
You're going to have to approve the plan itself. They're saying you don't have to do it, but they're recommending that you do.
Approve
the plan.
We have to approve it, or?
They are saying that it would be highly unlikely that a board shouldn't approve the plan. So my answer is yes, Gail. You're going to approve the plan.
Okay.
That March will start. If I'm lucky, we'll start it in January. If not, we'll end up in February because I have to get through 7 boards of education to get each plan approved.
So there's a different plan for each school?
No. They're going to have the same plan because we're regionalized for teacher development. But because we have 7 distinct boards, I wouldn't use one process with one board and not for another board. It'd be inappropriate.
can we see it as it develops?
We're not even close enough to show you anything yet.
Sign off on it.
I think what you're going to get after this next meeting, I hope, will have some sort of draft that will come out to the board saying, here are the state guidelines, and here's what we're going to do.
Okay.
We just haven't developed that yet. We're just not there.
Okay, but when things are developed, can we get it? You know, you want us to participate.
Mm-hmm.
We
right.
need to participate in this process as well.
Right. Once we get a draft together, okay. we'll start probably presenting this draft. But the difficulty in doing that, if we meet November 29th, and we have one more meeting in December to create this, because think about it, time's running short. We're going to have to come up with a skeleton of some sort that we can put next to that state guideline, because it doesn't do me any good to submit or you to submit a plan to the state that we know they're going to turn down.
Yeah, of course.
They ultimately are going to accept or reject it, whether a board approves it or not.
Okay.
That's their contention. We'll accept or reject.
Okay.
But yes, we're working on just the foundational piece now, what does good teaching look like? So we can collect the data in a uniform way. Next component is training principals on. So if I'm observing Scoot, and Jonathan's observing you, we actually give you the same rating. So we're calibrating how well those observations are going to be, and that's going to be a training session for principals and mentor teachers. We're including all the mentor teachers as well, or anybody that has an interest in learning, and that's going to take some time.
So the administrators are going to be collaborating to come up with the same rating for...
Well, we'll call that calibrating our measures. So if two administrators are doing side-by-side observations, mm-hmm. we need some inter-rater reliability, it's called. So we have to be within very close distance of each other to validate our instrument. Otherwise, if we're coming up with vastly different opinions about what we're seeing, there's something wrong. There's something wrong with either our collection instrument or there's something wrong with our level of understanding. So that's going to take a lot of time. I think what will happen is we'll end up having a year where we're sort of test running the model and seeing how it goes. Mm-hmm. We may have, after 1 year, a lot of ideas about changing it. And I'm hoping the state will let us have a change period after a year. That's being debated, but it's not yet decided. The group that's in the pilot had the year to play, construct, and grow. I'm not sure we will have a year.
But I mean, at the same time, too, there's another piece of this that, you know, there's a data piece of this where all this information that's being collected gets entered into a database that goes to the state. And the state's going to look at those, you know, those ratings, those evaluations, and they're going to determine, you know, I mean, if there's a school district where on a scale of 1 to 4, everybody's coming out rated a 4, the state's going to take a look at it and be like, wait a minute, you know, and at the same time, too, if everybody's coming out rated a 1, you know, they're going to be looking at this information and kind of determining, you know, is this effective and are people, you know, fairly and uniformly, you know, applying it to the different teachers as they're going through and rating it. That's where that calibration part that Patricia was just talking about comes into play.
What is the teacher union input on this so far?
My understanding is CEA's been involved in it. To what degree and how much? What's the group that the state has? Is the PIAC? Yeah. Administrators are so good at coming up with these acronyms and edubattable things that, you know.
Call them PEAKs, but they have been involved throughout the process, but more importantly at the local level, we have invited each of your 7 unions to participate in the group that's been working on this project. That's why we have so many people involved in this process. We have 20 plus members of principals and teachers working together to create this model.
Has the CEA at the state level been working with the state administrators?
Through the PEAK program.
I believe so.
Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, that included CAPS and CAVE.
Yes, CAPS and CAVE.
But it seems to me if we're a learning community and one of your issues is teacher evaluations, then one of our goals could be setting up 2, 3, whatever workshops to have ourselves taught about what teacher evaluation means to the school, because that's may ultimately impact the budget somehow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
May impact, like,
I
know,
union relations.
But isn't that a task, setting up workshops?
It's a
goal working towards a value of a learning community.
That's the hard part. Simplify it and get some consensus on whether we're setting goals or setting tasks.
You're setting goals. Then you have to set your task. You were closest with your statement, Gail. That was a goal. I didn't quite get a hold of it.
Neither.
But you had a focus on learning communities that included not just school-based learning communities, but adults as well. It included the tool of technology, I believe, mm-hmm. that would enhance collaborative learning environments. Now that's a lot. Marilyn said it. That's a lot. That's, you'd have to break out then action plans and steps for each of those.
Okay, so if that's a goal.
That's a goal. It's a big
one. What task that can we set ourselves to achieve that, or at least the first step of that?
Workshops would be.
On the teacher evaluation.
Okay, is that good?
Then we could try to do some learning, because if we want to create a learning community, then we have to learn. So if teacher evaluations in Common Core are the major components that the high school faces right now and the region, the more we learn about teacher evaluations, that's a task we can accomplish to help us achieve the goal. But then we can look at how Common Core impacts, you know, do the iPads work into the Common Core aspect? That might be good to know if we're going to spend $190,000 on 400 plus iPads. So understanding Common Core and how another task, purchasing iPads, can work towards fostering the learning community.
Okay, so can the task be the board will attend one or more workshops during this 2012-2013 school year, workshops on who's going to do it, who's going to present, who's going to be a presenter?
We've actually been trying to get the State Department to come out to Region 1 to do a presentation just on teacher evaluation model,
Patrice McCarthy's on the peak committee. You might be able to get her.
Be the path to our door.
Diane Ullman is in charge of it at the state level. We were hoping that they wouldn't charge us. But we'll work on that. I can find somebody that will do it.
Okay, so that's going to be the task.
That's one step.
That's just, as long as we have something that we're committed to doing, you know, this school year. Can't find.
You could probably have somebody come from Ed Connection and do a presentation on Common Core State Standards. They're very involved in rolling out those. They've been working endlessly.
Diane has been giving you a lot.
And that's actually a goal for the year that she has, is to really bring the Common Core to a practical work level for all of our teachers. And she's been working with groups, and you're right, she's been giving us a lot of information on Common Core. But if you needed more, I'm sure we can bring in, again, agencies to help.
Okay, so can we say we'll attend a workshop on teacher evaluation and one on Common Core? Two workshops would not be overburdened some of it?
And we've all talked about technology and we're moving towards that, but if we're talking about the feeder schools, I know what my school is doing, and I've heard what your school is doing, and I've heard some from you, but I haven't heard anything from the three of you about what your schools are doing that are going to feed in. So can I get a quick update as to where you guys are in technology? Because if we're looking at it as the high school, then we need to know, and I don't know what's going on in your three schools. Technology-wise, do you have iPads? Are you introducing them? Have you?
They do. No, they haven't been given out to the kids. I mean, we obviously have a technology teacher, and the kids have the computers, and they have the lab. And we also had a special program, can't think of the name of the teacher. Vicki. Mm-hmm. was in charge of taking some of the coursework from each of the teachers and developing computer-related activities for those courses. That's the way in which we were making the computer labs really relevant to what was going on in the classroom.
All of the schools are moving toward faculty at the elementary level, toward faculties having iPads.
But do they have them?
Who has them?
North Canaan does.
Kent is there. They were there last year, in fact, and I believe Cornwall is not quite there yet.
No, because originally what Cornwall was considering was doing was letting every
school. Not yet.
Was letting
well, they, yeah, they will soon.
Cornwall is considering letting kids bring their own devices, and so they would have had a variety of devices. And I think that they sort of moved away from that particular model so that all the kids will have the same kinds of devices.
Yeah,
I think that was exactly what Matt went through also.
Yeah. Well, that's BYOD versus one-to-one,
right.
And that's a decision that folks at a local level have to make.
Salisbury, they're working on it. And Lee H. Kellogg, they are not quite there yet. I think they want them, but there's some discussion in Lee H. Kellogg about whether they want wireless or not wireless. And the iPads are not very helpful unless there's a wireless system to teachers, so they're... I believe there's a belief that the teachers would like them, is my general understanding of that, but they're not quite there yet. So the lead schools right now are Salisbury and Kent and Sharon. Salisbury's not a lead.
Right?
It's Sharon and Kent.
Sharon was the first one.
And North Canaan actually is usually out in front of technology. They do a good job of, it's always been in the forefront of North Canaan's work. Not only with iPads, but smart boards, and they're typically
out ahead. Very good. Yeah.
So should we be pushing them Power School as well?
They are. Right.
I think you guys are always caught between the rock and the hard place from one perspective, even more so than I am. I mean, you know, I'm there with you too at the same time. You know, we're charged with moving the school system forward, improving student achievement, you know, promoting learning, developing teachers, and moving that whole aspect of the program forward. But at the same time, you have to be responsible to your constituency, and you're fiscally responsible to the citizenship behind you. And balancing those two things is very, very difficult. And, you know, this is not going to be a fun budget season to go through at all, because you're juggling all these different balls. You're looking at an evaluation process that's coming down the pipe that will have an impact on the budget. Common Core will have an impact on the budget. Technology is going to have an impact on the budget. You know, and I mean, I very sarcastically said, give me a blank check. Wouldn't that be a wonderful thing? That's one way we could do that. But we know that's not a realistic approach. So, you know, we got to balance all these different balls that we're trying to juggle, and at the same time, you know, be respectful of, you know, the communities that support us. Communities support the heck out of this school. I mean, it's wonderful what they do. But they're not giving us a blank check to do it. I mean, we have
the business of articulating has been going on for years and years and years, and gradually moved away from, and I know we're separate communities and we're separate school districts, but over the years, I mean, at one time we didn't even have common calendars. I mean, reasonably common. We only have one district left that's just slightly out of sync. I think it's North Canaan with their school year. Is that right? But in general, we've gone about the whole process of aligning the each curriculum. You know, common material, and you're going through this business of having better orientations up here. So I think that in a lot of ways, the individual communities have sort of given up on the idea that their own educational programs are different and unique. And they simply, then all the kids would come up here and they'd sort of get it all put together the freshman year, and it just doesn't work anymore. Mm-hmm. So in fact, a lot of that has already taken place, and it's just a lot of common material, and even more so with student success plans, with Common Core. I mean, a lot of that's just been sort of being forced on the community. There's still a lot of people that really, especially Cornwall, like the idea of their own programs in their own way, in their own time, and we'll work with everybody as much as possible. But we don't forget that we are different communities with different goals and so on.
Right, and you want to be very
pretty united around the high school, I think, at the present time.
No, and I mean, you want to be very respectful of that tradition and that history. But I also think, you know, you keep coming back to, you know, well, what's the goal? What's the goal? And I mean, and it's great. We got to keep coming back to that statement. But, you know, one of the goals has to revolve around fiscal responsibility. Yeah. I mean, it really has to be at that, because that's one of the biggest.
That's right there. That's your goal number four. Has to stay there until we accomplish it. I will let Sam take it down.
Right.
I think back to your question, Scoot. We have all had at the elementary school Redeker, because the high school used Redeker. So our databases did actually feed into the high school in some common fields. With the high school going to Power Schools, the elementary started looking at it last year. They're going to spend time tomorrow, the principals will spend time tomorrow talking about Power Schools and training and what kind of a program do they need to lay out to transition from Redeker to Power Schools. Because it's more economical to go to Power Schools, it's almost a no-brainer for them. It's how they're going to get there. So tomorrow they'll be talking about that and making some decisions as a principal group. And it's my sense from last year, they're all interested. They just haven't had the time to sit and talk about it. They need some pricing. Can we get some shared pricing discounts by going all together and bidding it together? Will they continue to treat us as individual districts? Does it matter? In numbers, maybe it doesn't matter to this company, but those are questions they will be grappling with. And then how to train people.
The elementary schools are looking for that for this upcoming budget season.
For 13-14.
Yeah.
Because they have to make those decisions. And I mean, pretty soon.
That shift to that database, I mean, I've already seen it on one scale, and we're about to actually probably see it on an even bigger scale in about 3 weeks, has improved communication, you know, because people are looking at the information in the same place and they kind of see the same students and you know, they have access to the same information. So the shared information among the support staff is that much stronger because now they don't have to run around and collect it paper-wise and data-wise or via here, you know, I'm going to email you. If you are the seven teachers of student X, I'm going to email each one of you and say, can you give me an update on them? Well, maybe you get it back to me on Monday and you get it back to me on Wednesday. Now I can just go on and pull it up and there's student X and I have all your information because the only requirement I've made of you as a principal, my directive to you is you must keep your grades in there and you must keep your grades updated. And we're about to, and we've targeted December 5th as a day that we're going to open up the parent portal and the student portal, which means now that our parents and the students are going to get usernames and passwords, and they're going to be able to log in via the internet in real time and see an update on their own progress and be that much more informed. And what parents and students be able to do, even though to a certain degree they already do it, but they'll be able to just email directly from those pages to the teachers if they have a question or a concern about an assignment or a grade or something like that. You know, and I mean, that alone, just opening up that portal along those lines, that's a huge step for this region. Because just geographically, we're the largest school district in the state of Connecticut. So be able to improve that level of communication is going to dovetail into that cooperation and that collaboration piece. You know, by putting a better venue in place that's going to allow them to communicate more effectively and in a timely manner. Because it is, I mean, to be very frank and very honest with you, I mean, that's something that we don't do well right now that we really need to improve in. And that's part of the conversation we've been having with teachers in terms of how are we going to improve that and what are the triggers that automatically kick in that make certain we're doing it when it comes to student achievement. What's that? For some people it is.
No, it's scary how far behind the real, you know, commercial world this region is.
I mean, when you look at public education in general is very slow and very, very far behind in terms of commercial business.
I mean, all this stuff has been done in the private sector.
Yep.
I mean, it's, yeah,
more
it's
than a decade ago. Yeah. Oh, yeah. But we also don't have the resources, nor do we have, you know, the same structures and setups and protocols that we have. So.
Things move slowly.
Well, we're supposed to be preparing the kids for the world. That's, you know.
Right.
Well, rest assured, you're ahead of some.
Yeah, that's true too.
What?
Oxymoron. I said we're trying to create, you know, get them ready for the world, and we're so far behind. That's what you said.
Do you remember a year or so ago I presented the Next Ed report from CAPS, the CAPS group?
Mm-hmm.
There was a fairly strong component in that presentation, and I can give you another copy, Matt. But there was a strong component about ways to personalize and individualize learning, and technology is a tool that's just made for that purpose. So there's a lot, that report's not going to go away. I think it's being revisited. It's going to come back to the state again through CAPS, and worth probably thinking about that in terms of long-range thinking.
Was that in K?
I don't remember if K was involved, but it was CAPS.
I have a copy. Well, that's just CAPS.
Was it just CAPS?
I don't know. I have a copy of it.
I think they agreed with the whole thing except for the 5-year term.
Oh, that could have been.
Yeah.
They had a whole stack of goals that they set. The goal is universal access to education versus goal to educate all students with high standards. So they talked about transformative practices. But yeah, I can't remember. It was a private foundation I think they worked with.
You have a heck of an opportunity on the table in front of you. You really, really do. With all these different things that are coming down the pipe as far as Common Core, teacher evaluation technology, you know, this place is rich in tradition and history and past practice and all those things. And you want to be very respectful of that But at the same time, you know, we have to step forward and we have to change some of the things we do. We don't want to just change for the sake of change. That's not what I'm talking about.
Right.
But what I am saying is, you know, you have an opportunity where Common Core and teacher evaluation, you don't have a choice there. Those are things that we have to do, and we have to do them differently than we've done in the past. So that's an opportunity for us to look at what we're currently doing and how we can move to these new things that are being implemented and, you know, pushed upon us, but it allows us also to move our program forward and bring about some of the changes that we're talking about and move in a direction that is going to take us where we want to go and the kind of high school that we want to see. You want to maintain the history and the tradition, but at the same time, that comprehensive package that is our high school that this community loves, we want to maintain that, but at the same time, we want to enhance and develop it. There's portions of it that are still in existence that, you know, are very antiquated, and we need to kind of look at, you know, is that, do we want to keep that, or do we want to replace that with something, you know, that fits the needs today? There's a lot of self-reflection and self-evaluation that goes on with that process as well. That's part of what NEASC is. Now, NEASC isn't due to come back around until 2017, but, you know, in the spring of 2014, we got to start talking about getting ready for that NEASC evaluation, doing the self-study, getting the committees going, and doing all those things again to prepare for that. So there's that, again, there's the opportunity for self-reflection and change if we evaluate ourselves and say, you know, this isn't really what we thought we were doing. We want to move in this direction. Let's pilot this and see what's going on. You know, and as far as the fit with some of the elementary schools, yeah, really, you know, a K-8 school is obviously very different than a high school. So the technology and implementation of technology in a K-4 arena versus like a 5-6-7-8 arena is very, very different. But there's parts of the Common Core that have technology standards and benchmarks that the kids are supposed to be able to do at the end of kindergarten, at the end of first grade, and that are very clear cut. So, I mean, we got to make sure that we're achieving those so as the kids move up and through, they've hit those benchmarks and they've cleared those standards so that when they do get here at the high school, the Common Core kind of gives them that mutually assured set of skills that are supposed to be productive. So when they land here, we know, okay, look, you had this when you were in fifth grade, fourth grade, sixth grade. You should be able to do it. And the curriculum, as you know, as it's being developed and different things are being rewritten and worked on, those skills and those things are woven into the curriculum, and it's defined, and you know, you've assessed it, and you know the kids have hit these standards, they move on to the next set, and it just kind of builds upon itself.
The last NEASC was already pushing you forward into a lot of these. If, for example, the whole business about the teacher being the center of the classroom, they really faulted us for having too many teachers who were right at the center, not enough interrelationships and learning between the teacher and the student.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's pretty clear that they were looking out ahead at some of the things we're talking about right now.
Yep.
And I assume they'll be looking out even further ahead on the next one. So it'll be, we'll still be in a position of trying to catch up with what their holding is responsible for.
I was going to suggest, depending on what you all want to do, if we're going to pursue the two tasks of teacher evaluation and Common Core, I think we've just sucked up the budget process the whole year.
Exactly.
Well, we have one goal about creating and supporting a learning community with two tasks that are attached to that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to start with that?
But they shouldn't cost us anything.
Hmm?
But they're not going to cost us anything.
No, by budget I mean between our budget workshops, doing workshops on teacher
time-wise.
Time-wise, it's got to be a problem.
That's a pretty big plate we've got in front of us right now. I mean, that doesn't mean the one goal about the learning community ends at the end of this year, but between now and the end of the year, we can be thinking about a new goal with tasks attached to it for next year and keep building on that, as opposed to sitting here and trying to figure out a half a dozen major...
Set one goal.
I like the idea of the workshops on the teacher evaluation. That would be interesting. As far as the Common Core goes, personally, myself, I think I get enough of it because I get it twice from the reading.
Yeah.
So that's my personal opinion on that.
We don't have to do a lot on Common Core. We could we could put more emphasis, because the teacher evaluation is probably going to impact the budget somewhere.
It's huge.
What might be interesting would be to have, Diane has presented sort of the global, but how will the Common Core, maybe you could have Matt present how the Common Core will impact the high school more specifically, and what he might do to promote Common Core at the high school, because it's different at a high school. He said his systems are different, how he puts teams together is different. How are they going to have conversations around the Common Core? Mm-hmm. So maybe it's just being more aware of how your high school's dealing with it is a better approach than just sort of us presenting more Common Core.
Or how it's going to impact.
Because it is sort of.
Well, and I mean, and some of that stuff simply goes back to the structures in terms of how is the day constructed and how does the schedule afford people.
How do you feel about Region 12 and the flexible schedule?
Well, there's a lot of things I like about the current high school schedule. There's some things that I don't like. And I mean, you know, like I said, I'm pulling a group of teachers together tomorrow after school to kind of talk about, does this schedule meet our needs? And when part of the conversation was with the new evaluation process and the Common Core, will it allow us to meet the needs that are being dictated?
Because you've talked a lot about time for professional development, time for evaluations, time for this. If there was a more flexible schedule, it might be easier to create that time, collaboration time.
No, I mean, it also depends on too, in terms of what do you picture in your head in terms of being a more flexible schedule? The thing that you know, and I keep saying this to folks, is we got to keep kids at the forefront of what we're doing. The schedule has to benefit the kids. The work that we do to develop professional learning communities has to benefit kids. How is it improving student achievement? What is it we're talking about here? What has this got to do with student achievement? You know, and that's where we got to keep our focus on when we're doing the budget. How is this budget going to improve student achievement? Is every little nickel and dollar in the budget going to, you know, focus? No, that's, you know, but I mean, you understand what I'm saying. But it's like overall, when we start looking at, you know, does this move us in the direction to help improve student achievement?
But if we were able to create more time for professional development, mm-hmm. that should extend.
It should. I mean, you know, and again, then it comes back to the tasks that we set out. I mean, like if you set up a structure that creates more time for that professional development, because right now there's not enough time for professional development. But where are you going to steal that time from? You know, there's some school districts in the state where every Wednesday is an early release day. You know, do you want to go down that road and even have conversations along those lines? But then you seriously got to look at how many instructional hours you're impacting there. Yeah, right. And it's even harder to do in a regional school district than just like a district like West Hartford. I think West Hartford still does that, don't they?
I'm not sure.
I don't know. I mean, I know they were one of the ones that always did. You know, they were the kid, every Wednesday was an early release day, and then there was 3 hours of professional development every afternoon. I mean, they had done that for a long time. Whether or not they still do or not, I don't know. But again, you know, you're taking the adults that need to be working with kids away from that task. That's got to be at the top of the list.
And time the parents will see that immediately.
I know.
That will be.
I know. But you know, that's where you're juggling that ball again. Mm-hmm. It's this time on task, teachers working with students for student achievement is paramount. But at the same time, you need to give teachers time to collaborate, be professional, and improve practice. You're doing this the whole time, you know, and how you structure that in the day, because, you know, there's only so many hours in the day, and then you start getting into contractual things, and, you know, union issues, and all these other things start impacting upon those lines, you know.
That's really what we need, more days.
That's
really what
we want to try to. At CCS, we want to try to extend the school day. What, about 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes? What?
Some schools have extended
by ten minutes. Just met with a lot of resistance.
Some schools have tried to add professional learning time.
Yep.
Some schools do early release, maybe not weekly, but certainly some of our schools are aiming for quarterly. Mm-hmm.
But you got to be very careful when you start dipping your toe in that water, because you got to look at the number of instructional hours. And the high school right now is just, I mean, that's one of the things we're going to look at, is if we do make changes to the schedule, does that increase our instructional hours and our time with kids? And I mean, and that's one of the things we're going to wrestle with tomorrow when we start tackling some of these problems, you know, because we can't make dramatic changes because we're so close to that line right now. So we got to figure out a way to kind of recoup some of that so we can move that forward and get that piece together. Because the teachers in this building would love to have more time together, be professional and collaborate. But where do they find it during the course of their day? Because I might be free and I might be able to, but you're in class and you're teaching.
Obstacles to somewhat elongating the school year? Does that become a contractual issue with the union?
Sure.
Right, because you're paying teachers right now contractually for 180 days. So if you start adding days, you're going to start, and now you're back to the fiscal responsibility.
So if you add, and if you add hours, it's extra.
Well, I mean, if you start lengthening the school day and or the school year, you're going to get into the contract, you're going to get into monetary issues.
So, Matt, for our one goal that we managed to squeeze out.
Which was a good one.
Do you have time to do a presentation to us on the Common Core? So that we can ask practical questions as to how it's going to be implemented and impact here at our school.
Yeah, I mean, we can put some stuff together and we can figure some things out. I mean, I have some questions in terms of, you know, exactly what do you want to see and what do you want me to present, but I mean, we can hammer those out at an additional time in terms of, you know, we can talk about that at a board meeting in terms of what do you want to see in that presentation. You know, there's some departments in this building that move way ahead. I mean, I know math is way out in front and has a real solid grasp of what they're doing with the Common Core and how it's going to impact their program and the changes they need to make and some of the things they've already done. The other departments are kind of catching up to that. And so, I mean, you know,
how it's worked for them.
We've talked about, you know, having different people come to you and do presentations for you. I mean, that could be something I can work out with the department heads. And, you know, I can bring forth either one or two department heads at a time and we can kind of do this piecemeal over, you know, January, February, March, or February, March, April, and we can kind of hit the core departments and you can sort of get an idea of what they're doing and the work that they've started. They use department meetings, they use, you know, we use different chunks of time.
You can also hear the obstacles that they're facing. That'll give you their challenges, you know, what are some of their challenges and what they might need to move this forward.
I'm really interested in the actual Common Core curriculum, what it is, mm-hmm. how it's different from what we have, like details of that. Not so much.
There's the crosswalk map and the gap analysis that they've done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what's different than what we've been doing, and remember about 20% is different than what we've already been doing.
We could download the PDFs and try reading those.
There's even an iPhone app for
them.
You can put it on your iPad.
People, we agreed to sort of take a break about halfway through. I think we're halfway through. We do have some food and drinks and coffee and so on. So, unless anyone has something really pressing that they need to say right now so they don't forget it, let's take a break. Ready, Grim? And reconvene. What do we need?
Your pleasure.
20 minutes and bring food back to the table?
Sure.
Is that okay?
Sure.
Whatever. Okay.
That's great. Thank you.
Then let's reconvene. Okay. Sounds good. Values, beliefs, and goals. I think, Mr. Harnett, have you finished HBRHS goals? Sounds pretty good to me.
Well, I mean, you know, it's an ongoing process, but I mean, I think I've kind of hopefully given you a good understanding of not only currently where we're at, but hopefully where we're going.
I think that's what we needed.
You know, it is a work in progress, and it's going to continue to grow, but I mean, you know, we're working on it.
We need to work from there on our goals. Right. Okay. That's fine. Values, beliefs, and goals. I think we just need further discussion. Who else would like to contribute at this time?
Well, I think we should work on this, the wording of the goal that Gail started.
Could we have a read back?
The goal is help support the creation of a learning community that includes board members, administrators, teachers, and students through technology-enhanced collaboration and encourage the elementary schools to participate. and the task is...
To help support the creation of learning communities.
She's doing it the old-fashioned way.
I know, but I have to see it.
Help support the creation of learning communities. Keep going, Gail.
No, she was saying in terms of her own writing.
A learning community that includes board members, comma, administrators, comma, teachers, and students through technology-enhanced collaboration. Mm-hmm. And encourage the elementary schools to participate. That's the goal part. The task part is, you ready?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The board will attend a workshop on the new mandated teacher evaluation with Department of Ed or Rescue, whichever, in order to educate ourselves on how the learning community will be developed with the use of technology. And Matt will do a presentation on the Common Core as it will be implemented in our school. So that would be the two workshops, two things.
A comment on the list of administrators, teachers, we're missing the parents or community piece.
Yeah, right.
Or somebody, you know, something there.
Okay.
Community?
Just parents.
Community?
Community members, okay.
Mm-hmm. Leave it open to be parent community.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And while it sounds silly, because I think your list is comprehensive, would it make sense to start with the students first? So it sort of accentuates Matt's priority of students. I know that's kind of silly, but students first and maybe ending with the administration. I mean, students and staff sort of.
Teachers.
So in the end, if you were to summarize this goal, you are going to support learning communities that will utilize basically technology collaboratively, and you will encourage uniformity throughout the region because you're going to bring the elementary people along the board. So that captures some of Matt's concerns.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Teacher evaluations, do we only want one more workshop? Or do we want to have?
We said one or more.
If I bring somebody out or can get somebody out from the state to do a workshop, it's probably better to have, I know it's harder, but it's probably better to have one sitting to do it.
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to get them to come out here. I know they're so busy right now, they sort of, it's a struggle.
Like 1-2 hour max.
Yeah.
Not, you know, keep it in a box.
So
it's
you don't want it all day.
But
we can
get
the
special. No, I don't want it open.
Well, I'm thinking we don't need to eat. CAPS could do Joe Sarasula would maybe do CAPS and maybe CAVE and maybe somebody from the State Department of Ed. So you might have a panel that gives you a quick overview of what it is, why, the rationale for it. And I'll play around with that. Is there a month you'd like to target?
See, to me, it sinks in better if you have more than one
session. Of course,
it
does.
When you have 1 3-hour session, it's like, well, I remember half an hour of that.
What if we gave?
That's the way my feet are.
What if we try to give you either electronically something from the state to give you sort of an advanced read of it, and maybe do a piece of it at a board meeting, and then have the state come in as a culminating experience?
That's good. That's
that gives good. You multiple sessions, Jonathan, because I think you're right. It's a lot to take in all at once. Or we could reverse it. We could have them come first, and we could have follow-ups.
I think if we read something, that way when the person comes, we can...
Pre-read it?
Be prepared to ask questions and make that trip for them.
That's where they are.
And I'll see what's available electronically.
Any questions?
Yeah, exactly. It's hard to, it's digestible. So would you say February or March? Is that too late, too soon? February, March?
I'm not here January, so I would like it February.
February's good.
Yeah, we'll say February.
Yeah, we'll try for February and see what we can organize. And I'm going to assume probably later is better than earlier.
Mm.
True? Is that true?
Yeah.
So like a 6 o'clock?
I'm just trying to think what the rest of our schedule is for the board of the year.
We don't have any budget meeting in February.
We didn't schedule any.
We have no budget meeting in February?
No.
Where are we?
Wait, where's the 27th? We have one on the 27th.
27th, early February.
We have two in February.
The week of the 18th, depending on...
We have two in December. No, you're right. I just want to have the list.
February 4th is our board of, regular board of meeting. And then February 27th at 4:30 is our budget workshop.
Somewhere in between that.
Yeah, right.
About midnight, I'll try for.
That we will need, okay.
Somebody from there might come out. Fred Dorsey, we know pretty well.
Marilyn, what were the dates you just said in February?
4th and the 27th.
27th, okay, good.
Is there a date while you're looking at calendars? Is there a date in February about mid-month that works for people?
Is there a break in February? There's a break.
President's Day weekend.
Yeah.
Which is the third weekend, is that right?
Usually are 19th and 20th.
Yeah, that's right.
True?
Yep.
Usually about that time. February 13th is open. That's a Wednesday night.
Well, all Wednesdays are good for me.
Wednesdays? Wednesday night, February 13th? Get you home in time for Valentine's.
No, but 14th?
14th is Valentine's.
That's candy board.
I know, they like meeting on Valentine's Day.
February 13th?
February, so I'll try for that. I don't want to promise it.
What time are you putting it on for?
Well, you tell me what time.
The only thing I have conflict is the Arbor Eaton Landscape meets on the 13th.
Uh-oh, early or late?
Well, their meetings are always at 3.
So if we did like a 6 o'clock time?
3 or 4, yeah.
Or earlier?
For presenters to come?
4:30?
Yeah.
4:30 is better?
Yeah, earlier rather than later.
Okay.
Because they have to drive home.
4:30 would be fine, because I'd be out of my meeting, so. And what kind of meeting are you doing on this?
Well, I would say a couple hours.
I think 2 hours, I think 2 hours is fine. I'd go for 2.
Is my experience. And if I can get you something in advance to read.
Yeah.
Or even their message in advance to read.
Let's put a time limit on it. Right.
Yeah, it would have to be library, because I think we might. And the other boards are interested. Would you be interested in inviting the other boards?
Sure.
Sure, oh, if you're doing it, absolutely.
Then we probably would have to find Matt if we could use 1:30.
No.
No. We would probably, the library doesn't work so well with the bigger groups.
I know we're setting a date and time, so this is information we should pass on to our board?
If you could give me a little bit of time just to confirm that we actually could get someone to come out, that would be great. We've emailed two different people, asked them. We've not heard back at this point, so. But we have no specific date or anything.
This is for the 13th, you want 1:33?
Well, we emailed a while back to see, the other board members have been asking for the same information. So we'll try to hold this date.
This is the 13th, you want room 1:33?
If it's available, please. And then we'll confirm. though, moving right along, we have. Yes. What is that blue thing over there? Right in front of you, a piece of paper.
It's the agenda, it came as a mail.
It's just on green.
It came on green.
Okay. So are we all set with four?
As I mentioned before, as we progress, I know there were some time issues with this, how long the meeting went on. And do you want to work with this goal and these tasks and see how this develops and then work towards creating more, or do you want to try to create more now? That's up to you.
That's great. Let's just do this.
I mean, I think
so long to get one goal. Let's just achieve the one goal and then do another.
I would agree. Teacher evaluations in Common Core take a little bit of time.
You not only got to look at the goals you have for stuff, you got to look at all the tasks outside that goal you have.
Yeah.
Responsibility for budget, you know, I mean, professional development, I mean, all these different things that you guys got to do. This is a pretty big goal. It really is. And it, you know, to figure out how you're going to measure it and whether or not it's been attained is a task unto itself.
And whether we need any policies. Because policies and finance is basically what we are.
So. And that's in addition to everything else you're already doing too along those lines.
Yeah, we were good meeting, policy meeting the other day, yesterday.
With the 3,000?
Yeah.
Yeah, same too.
Just right here. Okay, so. Okay.
Hoorah.
Well, at the retreat, they had talked about, doing a little advertising for some of our values. Do you recall that?
Yeah, but
I'm not sure where we want to go with some of that. They felt that if these things were actually worthy, that they ought to be made available in some kind of mass communication form.
Well, I don't think we have to go.
We don't have to go through that, but is there any point in it?
Well, we can figure that out. Like we've discussed, if we can accomplish what we've got here, we can start looking, you know, at other goals and. I mean, this does not have to be a static situation where we have one goal and achieve it and it stops.
Right. One of the things I think somebody brought to my attention, and I can't remember whether it was Sam or who it was, but during budget season, many boards will put in the front of their budget, here are our goals, this is what we want to accomplish, and here are some things that we're doing, and here are our initiatives in order to support and promote through the budget what you're doing. I don't know if that's of interest to this board, and would you want to do something like that in the front of your budget? I think Region 6 did that last year. You'll see commonly Region 12 will do that. We have done sometimes that piece. Mm-hmm. Here are our goals and vision and mission. But that's a place that you might want to think about.
Anything further?
I just want to say something on this list of values and vision, that citizenship is not a value. I think I mentioned this in an email. Citizenship is a legal status. It's not a value. And to subsume honesty, generosity, civility, commitment to public service under citizenship makes no sense whatsoever.
What page are you working from?
The one that says Region 1 Values and Vision.
Second page of the packet.
I got it.
So I would eliminate that.
Is this document now superseded by our new goal statement? That this was working towards the goal statement and now this is set aside?
I would think the goal and the task we set for ourselves right now are that whole thing for the time being.
Yeah, I think so too.
That material is reference. And it was always meant to just be a form of reference.
Right. Typically, your goals are based on your values and your beliefs. That's your core. And if you feel that your goal does embrace your core,
Well, Jonathan, did you want to do anything else with some of this material that came out of that workshop?
Not
at the moment. I mean, I'm not sure if not. Yeah, I'm not sure where we'll go with this. I realize some of this was all free association, so.
It seems like we've said.
Yeah, I think we're there.
These are just, I'm satisfied with that.
Does that mean you want to adjourn?
Yes.
You're ready?
That sounds like a great idea.
Being a rig, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion.
Second?
Second.
Discussion, all in favor?
One second. Do we need a motion to adopt this goal?
You can formalize it.
Do you want to formalize it now?
Or you can formalize it through a consensus of the group.
We still want to take it back to our board.
And you can still just have a consensus.
Make sure it's on the agenda for the business.
Love this technology.
I just got it, so it's the learning curve.
Right.
Cool.
Okay.
Can't be afraid to play with it.
No, I'm not.
You may have an agenda meeting coming up here.
While you're emailing, Sam, would you?
My wife doesn't hear, she mostly streams Netflix.
Why?
Well, I'm flexible on agenda, we don't have to do it. I don't care morning or afternoon. And, so we want to put that.
I have 6:39.
There's only one more scene that left.
I think, Phil, I moved this to the 26th.